to me. I hear it in my sleep. This is the beat. Blur it in your seat, blur it in your seat. This is the beat. You guys hear me?
This is the beat. I hear it in my sleep. Blur it in your seat. Blur it in your seat.
Yeah. Hey, what's up?
Hello?
Hey, Paul.
Okay, I'm gonna turn off the volume off the...
The music should be stopping for you guys now. Okay, I'm going to bring you guys in. Let's see how this works. Oh, man. Looks like I can... How do I do it so that both of you... Okay, so people are seeing either... How do we split screen?
Wait, are people gonna see us?
They see you. Yes, they're watching you. Sorry, was it well explained?
No. No. There we go.
Okay, how do I select all cameras? There we go. There we go.
Oh my God, I'm on YouTube.
You're on the YouTube.
Never do this.
Thanks for doing this. and thank you, Tamler.
I think David is up to something, Paul, but I can't for the life of me figure out what it is.
Am I Tamler now?
You.
Yes. Start doing some ASMR.
We have a good ASMR mic. Hello. Hi, Paul.
Oh, there we are. I see us now.
Yeah, good. There's a lag. So, Paul, this is your first live stream experience?
It is absolutely my first. I did not expect to be a video.
I'm very sorry. I remember I got Dan Ariely to agree to do some podcast that I liked, and it was live, and the minute they started, he had no idea that he was on video either. But you know, Dan could give 3/5 of, he like spit in his hand and did this thing, and that was it. Through my speakers to the mic, let me turn. They're hearing an echo. Paul, can you say something?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Our listeners are here.
There's something very disorienting about seeing you guys on delay like that.
I know. Just look at
the screen. Yeah, back.
What are you doing behind the curtain? There's a feedback loop going.
Well, fortunately, this is a tape, so
which is going great right now.
This is amazing. No, what's going on is that for some reason there's echo coming in from you guys.
We have our headphones on.
Yeah.
I have headphones.
Just make sure that the audio is coming through your headphones, I guess. I don't know what else.
Mine definitely is.
Okay. I am.
Let me hear. There's one possible thing. No, because it's coming through my headphones, so we have to.
Yeah, I think this is good.
Is it both of us that are echoing?
Close your YouTube window.
Okay.
And tell me if both
what
of
about
you,
now?
It's a problem on my end. Okay, I have. Oh yeah, it might have been. Let me do one last thing on my live stream. Preferences, audio, never. Okay. It's going to be a lag.
Is that better?
Okay, how's it going?
There's going to be a lag, but let us know if it's better.
Is that better? No?
Okay. I'm going to mute my... Still happening. I'm going to mute my microphone. Does that fix it?
You tell me.
All right.
It's okay.
Yeah, we're talking right now. Is there still an echo? Is that better? It worked, but you had to mute your mic. So unless Paul, Dave, maybe you can just sign your comments. Paul, you and I can talk. It's been a while.
That sounds good. Yeah, we should catch up. Wait, are people watching as we do this? The comments are coming in.
Yeah, they're letting us know whether there's echoes or not.
This is very humiliating.
It is.
Are they paying for this to get the opportunity?
Dave can unmute, it said. Oh, no.
Okay, I unmuted.
No echo from anybody.
I unmuted now, so we'll have narrowed down the problem. If the echo comes back, we'll know in 20 seconds.
Aren't you glad you signed up for this, Paul?
This is great. You know, we've done a million of these. I never knew this was going to be video. It's never a video.
What million? Who's done a million of them?
Well, with you guys.
Well, but this is a totally different thing. This is live.
I know. I knew that. Are you sure it's live?
Well, it's a 8 seconds delay in case for Dave's anti-Semitism violating YouTube policy.
I think we are.
Yeah,
it works. We figured it out.
All right.
Okay, now let's get to the real content.
The real content, which we don't have, which doesn't exist.
We have questions.
We do have questions, right? From Twitter, is that where I should look?
Yeah, I think we have some. Yeah, you guys look on Twitter. I'll pull up
Reddit.
Reddit.
Okay, I'm on
Paul,
Twitter.
There was one that came up both asking of your compensation that you get for being on our podcast, Paul. And I want to tell people that we do not compensate Paul because we made him. We made him an internet superstar, and if anything, the compensation should be going the other way.
Has anybody seen A Star Is Born?
No.
This is exactly.
It is.
I'm the Lady Gaga character.
I'm the alcoholic manager, yeah.
Yeah. And that's right. So you're bringing me up to a level of fame, and I will soon surpass you.
you have well surpassed us and left us just.
If you don't know how to move dance, well, it's not good for either one of you. But no, you do not pay me. I really should pay you. I'm not going to, but I should.
All right. Well, we'll send over our Venmo information.
Yeah. I'm going to join the OnlyFans. Have you heard of this OnlyFans? I think it's like Patreon for porn stars.
So homeboy's making fun of us on Twitter. We're spending the first 7 minutes of our live stream is trying to fix echoes.
Hey, you know, you got to give us credit. This is a high technical hurdle that I feel like I'm not getting enough credit from Tamler for adding this channel to our audience.
Definitely not. Yeah. I'm still wondering, like, I'm still very suspicious of, I feel like this is a way to move me out of the podcasting, your podcasting future.
So I've set aside 12 minutes for this. So we got 3 more. To go, I think.
All right, let's look at some questions.
Yeah, let's get some questions.
What does the current psychological literature tell us about drinking bleach? Need a fast answer. Thank you very much.
I tweeted something humorous about Trump recommending that people drink bleach, and many, many angry responses informing me with tremendous self-satisfaction. Actually, he suggested we ingest disinfectant into ourselves.
Yeah, I saw somebody say something along the lines of, if you distort Trump's lies by making them sound even more ridiculous than they are, then you're basically...
you're playing his game.
Yeah. Well, let me take advantage of his live stream to correct the record. He did not technically advise people to drink bleach. He said we should ingest disinfectant into our bodies, as well as somehow get very powerful light into our bodies. And as for all the people who say, well, he's just expressing perfectly good mainstream scientific fact, I will respond by saying that Trump himself said he was being sarcastic.
Oh.
Now, I don't think he knows what sarcastic means, but I still do not. I think this undermines the claim that he's actually expressing a novel scientific theory.
I'm just...
I would like to remove myself from this, I don't know, avalanche of contempt being thrown onto Trump for saying that, because I think that's exactly the thing that energizes his supporters, the perceived, smug elitism that got him elected in the first place. And, you know, he's full of shit, but he knows that he's full of shit.
Yeah.
And I think we should ignore these kinds of things rather than make it a big thing.
Wait, this is you. I thought this was leading to a joke. This was a sincere moment. This is a sincere political
moment. It was sincere. I hate when people sincerity? Like, oh, look, the Cheeto, the orange guy in the White House said drink bleach. Oh, everybody's so stupid. You know, the whole half the country is so stupid for voting for this guy. That's just the wrong way of dealing with this.
It was just a tweet, Tamler. a small attempt at in a world that doesn't like boomers anymore.
You're going to get him elected now with your newfound celebrity that we gave you.
Yeah, that would be ironic.
People in the chat are estimating how much Paul gets paid to be on Sam's podcast.
Oh, Sam's that's a different story. That's a difference.
$50,000 an episode is my that's the over under in Vegas.
That's right.
You know, the limo comes to my house and takes me to the
You're just recording the limo. It's just wait. Are
like
you
some
using
like high school basketball star getting recruited by like Alabama or something or Louisville?
Paul, are you even using your fancy Sam Harris microphone? I don't see it.
No, I'm actually not. I'm just using a cheap old Apple.
That's...
I'm actually contractually I can't use the Sam Harris stuff or anything.
That's what happens when you don't pay him. We get the iPhone. You don't even get the AirPods. You get like the old iPhone headphones.
I have honestly, I thought we'd be talking for a little bit before setting up to do this. I'm on the YouTube.
Now you're a star.
It's called YouTube, by the way.
Somebody asked on the Reddit what papers we have in the pipeline. Let's start with Paul.
Papers to write.
Start and end with Paul.
What are you talking about? I have I just released a preprint. Tamil, you don't follow my career enough. I feel so just dis.
Should, yeah.
Paul, book.
I have a few. I have something I'm working on for the New Yorker about how the world will be after COVID. And the main punchline is nobody knows. And the main punchline is when psychologists tell you, this is what's going to be happy, we're going to be sad, we're going to vote for Trump, we're not going to vote for Trump. They don't know what they're talking about. So I don't know if it's going to come out in the New Yorker because they were more hoping I would say something. But nonetheless, I'm working on that. I have a few more academic projects with led by a wonderful postdoc, Maddie Wilkes. We're doing a paper on speciesism in adults and children. Finding that that for adults, if you had to choose between saving the life of a person or a dog or a person or a pig, most people would choose the person. But for kids, they're not a speciesist. And if this gets out, we could maybe just spend some time talking about it at some point. So one of you now, what are you up to?
They're telling us the echo is back.
The echo is back.
Oh, the echo is back.
We I'm muting Mike.
Could it be? Does anyone are you all muting the YouTube thing? Oh yeah, it's not that because we closed it. Good again, but that's because you muted, right?
My YouTube is totally muted.
Yeah, mine too. It's not that. Okay. It's something to do with Dave's mic.
I think it might be something to do with my mic. So I while I'm. Why don't you talk, Tamler, and I'll mute my microphone about what you have in the pipeline?
Yeah,
I've been trying to work on this. I mean, I've talked about this on the podcast. I don't have that much more to say about it because, unfortunately, it hasn't made as much progress as I would have liked. It's surprisingly time-consuming, this whole teaching online thing. Yeah. And so I've been pretty much devoting most of my time to that. But it is something overly ambitious that tries to show, and it's I'm hoping it'll be a book project that tries to show that we are focusing too much energy, often in misguided ways, on quantifiable, measurable, the kinds of experiments, the kinds of criticisms that we talked about, I think the last time you were on in the first segment, Paul, that in psychology, but also in education, testing, in finance, in all, even in ethics and in criminal justice, that this focus on measurability, quantifiability is actually leading to a distorted understanding, often, not always, but often leads to a distorted understanding of the phenomena you're trying to investigate. And it excludes a whole part of the world that you have to include if you're going to have a good understanding of the complexity of anything that philosophy or the social sciences deals with. Again, wow. This isn't, it's not that there's no exceptions to this, but there's a lot of, at least what I think is going on, I see it a lot. And I have these almost conspiratorial grand visions about what this book could expose. But then I also think I might be losing my mind.
Do you have a title?
Not yet. Something about the illusion of objectivity. But so, I don't have a snappy thing yet.
So a while ago, the three of us were talking about research on whether parenting affects how their children grow up. And the evidence that they don't, that it's genetic and so on. And your response, Tamil, I remember, was saying that, look, they could have enormous effects. It's just not the same right sort of thing psychologists measure. We're taking measurement, our current measurement abilities, way too seriously. Is this book sort of continuing along that vein for everything?
Yeah, and I don't know how much I'll focus on social psychology because I think a lot of people are on that, and I want to sort of unify this line of thinking with other fields and other lines of inquiry, but that's the idea, yes. And I don't remember the specifics of that, but it sounds right that the things that they were only focused on, the things that they could measure and had to just by the way this experimental approach worked, they had to exclude the things that they couldn't measure. And those things are, you know, often equally or more important than the things you can measure. So all of a sudden, just the contingent fact that something is measurable becomes like, oh, this is the only way that parents could have an effect on their children.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the idea.
That's going to be great. I really disagree with that. Because,
no.
You know, there's always discussion. I've heard the same argument before. Some guy was on a Russ Roberts podcast, Brian Kaplan, arguing that education, university education, has very little effect by any way you measure on how people think and what people know. And then there was a back and forth, and I think Russ, who's a smart guy, went back and said, it has an enormous effect, just not the kinds of things you can measure. To which our response is, well, okay, why should I believe you?
are challenging it. The burden of proof is on the people who say that that the thing is measurable, or that it all that matters is what can be measured. So there's that, you know, not everything that measures, not everything that counts can be counted, and not everything that is counted can counts, or yeah, that can be counted counts, right? I butchered that, but
oh, I disagree with that so much. That's gonna be so much fun.
Yeah. I could see us
that if you say something has an effect, and I say, oh, what kind of effect does it have? And you say, oh, I can't show you. It can't be measured. Then I'm anyway. You know this. So your book will convince me otherwise.
Or you'll convince me otherwise, and then I'll abandon the project and work on something more tractable.
No, this is good. No, stick with this project. It's all nicely right. Counterintuitive.
Okay, I'm testing out to see if there's an echo now when I talk. I think I fixed it.
It's not you that's the echo. It's when we talk that there's an echo.
No, I understand the problem. Thank you, Tamler.
Thank you, guy that knows nothing about any of this technology. Yeah.
I checked this all plugged in.
We'll find out in 30 seconds whether I'm echoing. Tamler is single-handedly trying to ruin our podcast by only talking about movies and claiming that all psychology is false. In fact, did you just read the Cargo Cult Science?
I read it. I put it in our Slack. Yeah. And I had read it a while back. But yeah, I think he's talking about some of the things that I'm talking about there.
I assigned that to my grad students because it's such a good piece and prescient one just about confirmation bias general across the site. He has this great, great example. Oh, my God. Now I'm losing my voice. He has a great example of scientists who got a particular number wrong and how long it took them to get it right because everybody kept trying to do the experiment and they were tweaking things to get the original number. And just basically every time somebody got the right number, they'd be like, well, this doesn't work. Like, we have to do the experiment over again. Okay. People are hearing my clicks. So.
But that is, the clicking is culturally insensitive.
Okay. I've just offended somebody from, okay, I think I figured out the clicks too.
It's slightly transphobic.
I was so concentrated on the sound issue. Tamla, this is a book proposal you're working on?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. I feel like that makes it sound like it's more advanced than it's a more advanced stage, even though that's not an advanced stage at all. But people are saying you should mute your YouTube.
Yeah, no, they're doing their best to help out, but I think that it's the particular software that I have that was piping in my system sound effects. So every time someone chats, there's a little pop. And that was getting piped in. I think I muted that.
So what about you, Dave? Too. What about you? What's your...
Yeah, so I'm working actually on a paper on moral praise with Molly Crockett and my grad student, Raj Anderson, that I think is the most exciting thing right now. We just put out a preprint, by the way, about effective altruism. I sent it to the...
We discussed your preprint in my lab group.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Oh, please don't tell me how it went.
No, people, we liked it.
Yeah.
Like, we have some thoughts.
yeah. There is no, it wouldn't be a good discussion if there were no critical thoughts. But this paper with praise, like moral praise gets like not talked about that often. And it's interesting. One of the reviewers who came out of the closet as a reviewer said, it's still popping. I'm just going to cut the chat. Let's see if it stops popping. No, it's still popping for me too now. said that we had it all wrong, that nobody has ever thought of moral praise as the opposite of moral blame. Like, nobody actually thinks that moral praise has anything to do with responsibility. And that seems weird to me, right? Like, isn't moral praise just actually when you do something good and you're responsible for doing that something good? So we're looking for people to straw man who say that clearly.
So sorry, you're disagreeing with what view?
Yeah, so we're saying that the idea that moral praise is just sort of the flip side of moral blame, that you calculate sort of moral responsibility, and if it's a good thing, then you get praise. If it's a bad thing, you get blamed. Yeah. And so what we're doing is we're reviewing all the asymmetries that we can find where praise is different than blame. And one of the reviewers was like, no, nobody ever said praise was anything about moral responsibility, actually, which kind of confused me.
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's enormous literature on, you know, why making the case that people try to do good to increase their reputation. And I guess praise viewed broadly is part of that.
Yeah.
It does seem like there is a big asymmetry. It would make a bigger difference if somebody, you know, went around and said, I'm a horrible person and I'm a racist and I'm a liar and I'm a thief. Then if somebody went around and said something good about me, as often happens, the force of the good would not be anywhere near as powerful as the negative of the bad. Is that what you're going to argue?
Yeah, something like that. And I mean, part of the argument is that getting blame wrong is so costly, right? That you can actually ostracize people or condemn them to death if you get blame wrong, and that's not a good thing. But there's really low cost to praising somebody by mistake. Suppose
you went on Twitter and you praised Charles Murray for his courageous book, The Bell Curve. You just got around to reading it. You said, brave and wonderful. Certainly there's some.
He's on to something.
I chose that example. But certainly there's some risk, right, if you praise a bad guy. If I say, well, Jeffrey Epstein, you know, he had his problems, but that guy had some good ideas. What's the famous tweet by this guy who says, you know, I'd like to correct my previous tweet regarding ISIS. You actually do not have to hand it to them.
I wish VBW No Contest was here for Paul Bloom saying Jeffrey Epstein, you know, there's some problems, but he had a lot of really good ideas.
Have you seen, by the way, that the latest season of Curb Your Enthusiasm where Jeff Green gets confused for Jeffrey Epstein?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. He does look like him. It's very funny. All right. What other questions do we have?
I don't know. These pop sounds are going to... By the next chat, I promise I'm going to get rid of the pop sounds. I cannot...
Well, this is the first time you're doing all three people. So.
Yeah, that's true. What other questions?
But who's the person that thumbs downed this YouTube thing, by the way?
Right.
Like, you didn't have to come and see it, you know?
It's free. Let's go do something else.
This is free. There's so many other things on the internet you could be doing. You could be streaming, like, on the Criterion Channel, 1,000 great movies.
That's right.
Isn't that a weird paradox of pleasure? That right now, on our laptops, we can see any TV program, and we're no happier.
We're just doing this instead. Yeah.
Somebody corrected me, by the way, that it was Weinstein, not Epstein, which is true.
That's right. It was Harvey Weinstein. I actually don't know how Jeffrey Epstein. What even? Dave, you went to like a lot of the same functions as he did.
Just
right?
One. Just one. But, Paul, were you ever one of his functions?
I was not. I was not, but you were.
Yeah, I know.
I have the picture. I'm going to put it on Twitter.
We're not talking.
I'm giving a thumbs up.
Jake Seelsdorf asked if we've watched Devs. I know, Dave, you haven't. But no. I have.
I've heard.
Paul, have you?
Not. I have not. Yeah. I'm watching Westworld, and it's kind of enough philosophy in TV for me.
Yeah.
I've seen a preview for Devs, and it seemed very heavy-handed. Free will and this sort of thing. Is it? Have you seen it?
Yes.
And?
Yeah, and not I couldn't get into it. I couldn't get into the characters. I thought the writing was really bad. There are two characters, and they're two central characters who speak almost entirely in exposition. Their whole goal is to give the history of their relationship, the history of what's going on, and then, you know, the philosophy at times is interesting. The one thing that it has going for it is beautiful. It is really cool. It is great filmmaking, just, you know, like some of the best filmmaking you'll see on TV. But every other aspect of it is kind of insufferable. So I'm not a fan, but I get that some people are.
I think I fixed the pops.
You fixed the pops.
The pops.
Just as we're about to wrap up.
No, this shit is going on for the rest of the afternoon now that the pops are fixed.
And now you can contribute to the actual conversation. Oh, Tiger King. Did you guys watch Tiger King?
Every bit of it, yes. I started feeling ashamed two-thirds of the way through, but I did watch it all.
Yeah.
I haven't started it. It seems like everybody, all they were saying was how horrible the people are on it. And I get that if I had started watching it, I might enjoy that the people are horrible. But now that I know that I'm going to get ready to watch people be horrible, it seems like not something I want to start.
Yeah.
I feel morally tainted.
So we finished off McMillions last night, this HBO documentary about a scam involving stealing winning tickets for a McDonald's game. And it's kind of the opposite of Tiger King, because you end up, with some exceptions, having tremendous sympathy for the people caught up in the crime. And it's warm-hearted in a way Tiger King isn't. Huh. I recommend it better, actually.
Huh. I've heard that's good. Yeah, Tiger King for me wasn't bad to watch. You were interested in what was going on, but you felt bad about yourself afterwards, and it was never that engaging.
Yeah,
I was describing it to somebody, somebody was telling me it's like going to McDonald's. It kind of tastes good, but it's not that good. What I compared it to was like jerking off for the third time in a day. It's like it feels good, but it doesn't feel that good. And then you just kind of wonder what's going on with your life that's what you're doing, you know?
I like that metaphor.
Did you ever think of becoming a professional reviewer?
I have. It's for some reason they don't seem to be knocking down my door to publish my thoughts.
I saw someone tweet that they were, during this quarantine, they were masturbating, not because they were ever actually horny, but because that was the only thing they could think to give them a shot of dopamine. And I get it. It's just like, you know, maybe I should just... I wonder what the Pornhub numbers are exponentially up. Have they released anything about this?
Oh, that's a great question.
Especially if you're doing it because you're not horny, like the length of the video watching might actually take people longer. So they might be finally seeing the end of their favorite videos.
Before we talk about Pornhub's numbers, Christopher Mayfield said he saw Calvary and he said it was super good. And I'm glad, because that is a really, really good movie.
What movie is that about?
It's by John McDonough, Martin McDonough, who did In Bruges and Three Billboards Seven Psychopaths. And it's his brother. He's done two movies, and that was definitely his best. And we talked about it. I may have brought it up in one of our
Wait, it
like,
was better than
five.
In Bruges?
No. Oh. In Bruges is awesome. Like, I love In Bruges.
Yeah, I know.
I think we should do In Bruges.
Yeah, we'll do. I think
they're making a sequel to that or something, right?
How?
I think, but I don't know. Some of the same characters.
Okay, back to masturbation.
Oh, Pornhub numbers. Sorry. I didn't mean to distract. That's like about Catholicism and like the Catholic priests, the way they handled the sexual abuse. So here's my question about the Pornhub numbers. A lot of people are in houses with a lot of people.
Yeah.
And so that makes it a little tricky, I'm assuming.
Yeah.
Based on my own experience.
Getting a lock on your door seems like an essential service during the quarantine.
But then that's suspicious that you're locking your door.
Well, at least it prevents the surprise entry.
Right.
This is no joke. You know what I have rigged up for various reasons is I have like Philips lights throughout my house, you know, the internet connected lights, and you can get these little motion sensors. And I have a motion sensor in my hallway that alerts me, turns on a light in my room if there's somebody walking toward my room. It's like a Star Trek red alert.
That's very useful in this context. Yeah. That is.
Our commentators, by the way, corrected me. It's not a sequel. It's a movie with the same two main actors and director-writer. Right. Seems right.
It's like the...
What is?
The Bruges one, in Bruges. So it'll have Colin Farrell and...
What is? In Bruges to what?
I said there was going to be a sequel to In Bruges, and that was mistaken. There's going to be another movie with the same actor, same director.
Oh, cool.
Right, like the...
Yeah, Colin Farrell is his kind of muse, it seems like, or his guy, his De Niro, if for Scorsese or something.
Yeah. Did he do Lobster? It's the same...
What?
Lobster.
The same director do Lobster?
No, that's Yorgos Lanthimos.
Oh, okay. I love it.
Like, check out the big brain on Tamler.
Yeah.
With all his director
when
knowledge.
When it comes to movies. Yeah.
Who was the best boy? that's some Michael Jackson shit, Dave. No, that's like, who was the newscaster who had that little button underneath his desk that would lock the doors?
Jake Tapper.
Jake.
No. No.
It was the morning guy.
No, right. Sorry, that's something I just know privately.
Matt Lauer.
I shouldn't have said
that. Matt Lauer.
Matt Lauer.
I don't want to get caught up in your lawsuit.
I actually want to talk about this genuinely. So J.D. Tamucci says, academic writing generally has certain rules that are used in everything from academia to politics. Not everyone learns it. Do you require your students and or advisees to write this way? And I want to disagree with the premise, because there is some, this is where I'm going to do a little bit of brown nosing to Paul's writing, because I think that I was learning to write the bad way that academics write. And Paul actually, and Peter Salovey were one of the two people who taught me either through example or explicitly, like if there's a simpler way to say something, say it that simpler way. There's absolutely no reason to try to sound like an academic. And I think my first couple of years in grad school, I was trying to sound like an academic, and people don't get over
Nobody
that.
Likes that.
Nobody.
Yeah.
You would, thank you. People write differently. You have to write differently for a journal, a scientific journal, than for a piece for Aeon or New Yorker or New York Times or a tweet or whatever. It's just there's a different register. To answer the question, students do have to learn it. It's even if you're a very good writer, you have to learn to write a journal article. But I totally agree. You could write a journal article badly, like most people do, where it's just unreadable. Right. Or you could write it with wit and with style and with intelligence. Right. So to compliment somebody not in the room, Dan Gilbert, I will read a Dan Gilbert paper. I will read it because I know it'll be a pleasure to read. It'll be clear and funny and smart.
And
the same time obeying the constraints of academic writing.
And it's hard. One thing that I do agree with is it's hard to hear someone's voice as an author in an academic paper. Dan Gilbert is one exception, obviously, because of the constraints of academic writing. And finding your voice, something I don't think I've done because I haven't written a book, but it's something I know that I've heard authors struggle with, sort of getting that. I think, Tamler, you talked to me a little bit about sort of, you know, trying to figure out what your voice was when you're writing this, the book on honor. Paul, I assume figured that shit out a long time ago, or do you still, is your voice just there?
I have a certain way of writing that's somewhat distinctive. It seems presumptuous to call it a voice.
Well, your voice, do you feel, you know what I mean? Like you feel like it's...
I feel like it. I have a lot to learn to be a writer. I'm trying to be better. And so I try to be reflective. So, for instance, I've noticed that a lot of my shorter pieces, I think everything I've written for New Yorker, have a certain style, a certain structure, and I'm trying to shake free of it. So often, for instance, I start off by saying something, I make it perfectly plausible, I go further with the argument, and then I undercut it. I think that that's fine for a bit, but you want to do other registers and other ways of talking. I tend to talk to the reader a lot. I tend to say you and ask questions and so on. And I settled into a certain style, but I'm trying to work with it.
Okay, here's a question, Tam.
So I want to.
Oh yeah, go for it. Yeah,
just to add on to that. So, I think that academic writing and that style is really not helpful to people, and I think people are misled by their professors I came to grad school not at all from an academic writing background, and people told me that my style was going to be an obstacle for me in my career, and it turned out to be the exact opposite. People, if you write not in that torturous, horrible way that other academics write, people will appreciate that, even when your ideas may be not quite up to the level and rigor of the discipline. People will appreciate at least the writing of it. It'll be a breath of fresh air for them because they have to read it.
Yeah.
And so I think that you should try to write in a, like, have some style, have some energy, have some enthusiasm, have some humor. Paul, you're really good at this too. You're really good at this. Like, it's fun. Like, it can be funny what you write. Even your academic stuff can be really funny, and it comes as like a person talking to you. And nope. I think like that's just doesn't, people will say that'll make you sound superficial, but it's not true. That's just what, that's them projecting on what other people will likely think without, you know, having any real basis in reality. That hasn't been my experience at all.
I'll totally agree with that. I'll just add, the bar in academia is extremely low. If you just write a little bit of clarity, put some concrete examples in there, make some effort to be understood, you'll be better than 95% of the stuff out there.
I find that with my students, it's the writing is sometimes the bad writing is not the thing that needs to be addressed. It's the muddy thinking that makes its way into the writing. And I feel like the less clear you are about what you want to say, the more words you toss in there, and it ends up confusing the reader because the mind is confused.
Yeah.
So somebody says in the chat that relative justice was often arduous to get through. And I do look back at that book, and I think like that was maybe the nadir for me in terms of getting drawn more into an academic style that's just not suitable for me. Like, I think it is suitable
for
some
people.
To be fair
to you, it was an academic book, right?
It was an academic book, for sure. Yeah. But I don't think I needed to write it that way. I don't think I needed to have all those acronyms and all that, you know, like I regret that.
Yeah.
Because I'm proud of the content in it, but I look back at the writing and often I say, what was I thinking there? And I don't think you see it as much in Why Honor Matters, or certainly, you know, Very Bad Wizard.
Though it pops up occasionally in articles that I've published, always academic.
I wanted to quickly answer a question from Pyre Girl about what my favorite VBW episode is. It's hard to keep track of all, but I love the Ecclesiastes ones, the Ecclesiastes one, and I love the all of the Borges ones. I think those are the ones that I've had the most fun with.
I'll tell you,
I like the ones with Paul on them, but
yeah, that's just me.
Michael asks, why are these guys not asking us any questions? A little self-absorbed.
I was laughing at
them. Michael, what's your favorite? What's your favorite episode of Very Bad Wizards?
What do you think about us?
What do you think about me? Paul, have you ever considered, or have you? I don't think you have read your own audiobook.
Oh God, no. I mean, you're hearing my voice now.
so your voice is fine.
For me to say, I will not read my own audiobook. There's probably a philosophical term for something that proves itself true as you say it. And I've always had good readers for them, and you get to choose. Which is very interesting. For my last book, Against Empathy, I got different options, and they're quite they give you different racial categories, different age categories, gender, and I said British woman, and they said fine, we have four British women. Check out their clips, and I just chose somebody who sounded great. But it's funny, for the first time in my life, and this is a pandemic-related thing, I'm listening to audiobooks, and I finished this book, The Glass Hotel. By the same author, I'm blanking out on her name, who wrote Station 11, which I'm now reading, a pandemic book. And it is so beautifully narrated. It's so beautifully narrated. The narration is sort of part of the art form. There's the writing of it, and there's the narration of it. And people could do that well, and I can't do that well.
Do you think that our writing would be served if we read it out loud to ourselves more often?
Yeah,
I try to do that.
Yeah, it's a very weird thing when you read out loud to yourself, and you're like, "What? Wait, what the fuck? What is the structure of this sentence, and how could it have made sense on paper?"
And I went through a brief period, but this is a cruel thing to do, where when you're meeting with a student, you say, "Well, why don't you read out?" And you're going over to writing. Why don't you read out that paragraph out loud? But and then basically to illustrate the fact that it's gibberish. But then I stopped doing it because it's just cruel. But often you realize, you could start crying when you start to read it, and you realize it has no rhythm. I think for the most part, good writing has to sound good when you read it aloud. It has to approximate the rhythm of good hearing. No, it's not the same as speech, typically. It's much more complicated, more ornate. Your memory could hold more and so on. But still, it should sound good when you read it.
I once spoke to a voice acting coach, and I don't know why this seemed so profound to me. It seems like very reasonable advice, but he said, read this out loud. And then he said, now read it as if you were talking to somebody that you know. And the difference in my reading, in thinking about somebody being right in front of me, was weirdly different. And not that I would ever put somebody through having to stand there while I read an academic paper to him, but it is hard to keep that in mind.
You're not a philosopher.
Do people still do that?
I think some people still do, yeah.
Oh, yeah. People talk about the play diet episode.
Yeah, they love it. I'm telling you, we should go back. Oh, here's an idea.
Audio commentary.
Tell us.
That was
yes, exactly. That's what I was thinking of doing. Exactly right. We're on the same page. We should totally do that. Just like not listen to it. We have to pledge to not listen to it before, and then just do commentary on it. Just play it, and either of us can stop it at any point and talk.
It was so upset. It was like mommy and daddy are fighting, and oh, they're gonna break up. Oh no. And
okay, I have a real question for Paul. When you first, maybe before you first came on our podcast, I don't remember what number it was. What did you think of what the fuck we were doing?
You mean like from a career standpoint?
Yeah. I mean, you were very nice about it at the time, but I'm sure that you were.
I don't remember. I was very curious about it. I mean, these were early days. Mm-hmm. You guys got fairly early. Somebody emailed me the other day. I'm starting a podcast. You know, and okay, that makes sense. But this is like, hey, I'm going to start a blog. it's now it's so established. You guys came in pretty early for academic podcasts, and I found it surprisingly enjoyable.
Yeah.
But it turned out, and this is going to be praise. It turned out that I listened to you guys talk a few times and said, this is amazing. Podcasts are great. And I started listening to other ones and they weren't great. So there's something unique about the two of you bouncing back and forth. You're pretty smart. You're pretty funny. And, you know, and you hit deep issues and you hit superficial issues. And it really goes over well. I can't. There's other podcasts I get different stuff out of. Like I would list because I have some degree of expertise in certain topics. But this is one I enjoy the most. So it's an unusual starting point for me.
Yeah, that's
thank
very,
you, Paul.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Let's be less navel gazing now. Now that I got the praise that I was seeking so desperately from Paul.
Somebody asked me what I think of later Wittgenstein.
Paul. Oh wait.
Sorry, Paul. Were you talking?
No, I was not. The later Wittgenstein.
Yeah.
Not the Tractatus one, but Philosophical Investigations.
Exactly, yeah. Which I have to say, I hadn't really read with any care until I just assigned it in a grad seminar this past week. And I, you know, a lot of people have been saying, your views are like late Wittgenstein. And I had read about him and it sounded right. He's very much against this idea of necessary and sufficient conditions, approaching concepts that way. He thinks that totally misunderstands what's going on with language, and I totally agree. And so I'm almost fully on board, and I'm interested in the style and the genre that he writes in. You know, it's not aphoristic like Nietzsche's aphoristic, but it is these short kind of numbered paragraphs that allow him to go into tangents when his thought heads in that direction. So I'm interested in the way that his style or the genre that he's writing in complements his thought. And that's a new thing that I'm interested in, is how the style that you're writing in actually is connected to the philosophical content of what it is that you're saying.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I think Wittgenstein perhaps was a genius, certainly thought of himself as a genius. So he wrote it as a genius. He wrote these quasi-aphoristic things. He didn't make any effort to be understood, but ideas his genius would shine through. And honestly, Tamler, I'd rather read you. I mean, I tried to
fuck geniuses. Let's read Tamler.
Yeah, let's read the
I'm sick of reading all these smart
people. I'm like Trump. Like, yeah.
No.
Sick of all these elitist geniuses looking down on me. I'm going to read Tamler. No, can understand.
I just think that there's an obligation for even among geniuses, there's an obligation for clarity. And I know a lot of smart people. Noam Chomsky is by any standards a genius. He's certainly not an elegant writer, but he tries to be clear. He tries to be clear. He doesn't work for obscurity. He isn't purposefully difficult. He's not a gifted writer, but he's trying to get it out there. Some of the people I know who are among the smartest people in the field, like Steve Pinker, are also the best and clearest writers. So you can be a genius, and you don't have to write like Wittgenstein.
Well, I mean,
or
I don't think. Do you really think it's so? He's not like obscure what he's writing. It's just not. It's a little more disjointed than you would otherwise find. But otherwise, the sentences themselves are fairly clear. It's not like reading Derrida or something or Heidegger. I don't know. What do you think of Nietzsche? Do you have the same complaint about Nietzsche and that kind of hyperbolic style?
I haven't read enough of Nietzsche to judge, but I find Wittgenstein, obviously he's not Derrida or like Kant or whatever, but he's very difficult. You're right. He has a simple prose. I think philosophical investigation begins with some discussion of a language being created with the word slab and things being moved around and so on. But he doesn't step back and say, so the point I'm trying to make is, you know, and here's what I'm arguing. He doesn't deign to do that because he's a genius. So
he trusts his audience.
So take Jerry Fodor, a great philosopher, passed away. Very funny, very cruel sense of humor. I disagree with him a lot, but he will tell you what he's saying. He says, in this article, I'm going to argue for this. Watch me do it. And he will say, you know, you might think the other thing. I'm going to show you why that's stupid. And at every point, he's talking to you. And, you know, and I love that. Life is too short to struggle to understand someone else's ideas. There's so many ideas out there. I take that back, but still.
I guess I think that's a style. Like the Fodor Pinker style is one style. I think there are other styles and that can still work and can still engage the reader and bring the reader in to be more, maybe a more active participant in getting the ideas. I think Plato is like this. You never know exactly what Plato himself believes, but that part of that brings you into the dialectic. And I don't know, like, I think there's room for both. There's definitely bad versions of both, but there's also good versions of a lot of these different kinds of styles and genres. I don't know which one I think Wittgenstein
is. That's fair enough. And somebody mentioned in the comments Steve Pinker's book, A Sense of Style. And there's another book, I think that's a terrific book on academic writing and writing in general. Another one is Clear and Simple as the Truth by Turner and a guy's name I forget. But it talks about the classic style, which is the clear presentation of ideas. But there's other styles. And you're right. I like the classic style, which is what we call clear writing. But I wouldn't say it's the only style worth reading.
Just to transition a little bit between the writing and speaking, there is, I think I've told this story before on the podcast, but Paul, there was this professor of art history at Yale who retired, I think, in my first couple of years there. And I remember Peter Salve telling me to go to his class. He said, just go check out this class. This guy's retiring this year. And I went, and the guy, it was the most beautifully delivered lecture I've ever attended.
Yeah.
It was clearly memorized, but not to the point of him losing the meaning and the inflections. And it was timed, you know, it was slides, right? So it's slides of these great works of art, and it was timed. Yeah, you know, somebody else had to be controlling the slides, but it was timed so well that whoever was controlling the slides was perfectly in sync with this guy. And he just was up there speaking with no notes. Yeah. And at the end of class, everybody applauded. And turns out that was true of the end of every class. And I look at the way, I love lecturing and I love being informal. But sometimes I just wish that I had it in me to be an orator, to just get up there and not even one wasted word.
I'm at University of Toronto right now. I'm in Toronto now visiting, and Jordan Peterson is from here. And whatever you say about Jordan Peterson, there's a lot to say about Jordan Peterson. He was exactly that.
Really?
People would come into his classes who weren't enrolled. They would just fill up the class to hear him talk. And he would stand up on stage, he'd have no notes, no nothing, no slides. And he would talk. And people would be transfixed, Svengali, hypnotized.
But see, I only saw him give a conference talk once, and it was confused gibberish. So I mean, maybe it was just preparation versus...
I think there's no shortage of Jordan Peterson talks on the internet. And I think if you see him talk to a large crowd in a stadium-like hall, you will see him move into that sort of preacher-like register, which is different from the classic style, actually, the sort of preacher style. And it's very powerful and very polished and very smart. And And I'm not making comments on the content. I've heard somebody say, oh, that's crap. But he talks in such a way that there's no point where you would say, you know, well, okay, I'm gonna turn this off and then go do something else. But I got to listen through this part at least. And at every part you're in, you've listened for an hour.
Now that we're going to have to be probably doing all of our lectures online.
No. Really? Fall, you think?
Probably by 2023, I think the classes will reopen.
No,
maybe fall. I don't know. Do you guys have information? So Yale is going to let us know in July what's going to happen in the fall. And the worries are, it's not that hard to do certain things, but dormitories is going to be a challenge. Yeah. So do you guys have news from your respective institutions?
No.
Our provost said 50-50, leaning on one side of the 50.
The wrong side, right? Yeah.
So would that be that Cornell would not open physically?
So the idea is that graduate students would be here, but they might not open it to undergrads. Now, if you had a child who was going to start school this year, would you even have them enroll?
No. This is going to be why we are getting pay cuts.
Yeah.
I definitely wouldn't. What's the point of them taking online college courses, you know, when they could just wait a year?
Yeah. And it's particularly an issue for a place like Yale, which is, you know, one reason people go to Yale is to be part of a community of other people who go to Yale and establish social contacts. And there's a lot of great places. I'm very proud of my institution, but it's not so good at seeing it on Zoom from your parents' basement is going to be worth it.
Yeah. Whereas, like, University of Phoenix probably has a better curriculum than you know, Cornell prepared the semester before.
We'll probably be a little better if they give us a couple months' notice. We'll be a little better maybe at putting it together. But this isn't what Paul did a Coursera.
Yeah.
So Paul has more experience, but I've never done anything like that.
But even the Coursera was for what it is, it's amazing. It's a free course that you could take online. But if your goal is to match the classroom environment, you know, as I recall, it's just a camera on Paul giving his normal lectures, right?
So it's complicated because in some way I taught intro psych this semester. We went online, you know, halfway through the course. I told them to watch my online lectures and we had Zoom sessions where my teaching fellows and I would meet the students one-on-one. I had more student contact hours this semester than I ever did ever teaching this. And it's not obvious what was lost by going online. And I'm in a lecture hall, there's 300, 400 kids. They don't get to talk. They just see me on stage talking.
Yeah.
So it should be no difference. It should be online has features that lecture halls don't. The reality of it is there's something to being in the flesh.
Yeah.
Totally.
And it's hard to quantify what it is, but there's really something there.
Yeah.
It's hard to quantify, so nobody pays attention to it.
It's hard.
It doesn't really matter.
It's people who don't believe that quantifying is possible are ruining the ability to improve this if we only could measure it.
I'm standing in the way of us going back to face-to-face.
According to Tamler, you can't even measure dicks. Like, what kind of world are we in?
There's so many things that that are intangible, you know.
That's the real motivation behind your stance. Who's to say?
I don't want to be just known as the guy with the 14-inch, you know, like, there's more to it than that.
Paul, I feel like we've kept you on long enough, but do you have Tamler and I were talking about future episodes and classic papers, maybe in memory, maybe in cognitive science. Do you have any suggestions?
Oh, that's a good question. I might want to go to some classic work by Chomsky, by Fodor.
That critique of Skinner.
So Chomsky's review, there's been a little bit of Twitter action. Chomsky's review of verbal behavior, I think, is absolutely essential reading, because it's not what everybody thinks it is. Everybody thinks it's Chomsky. You know, Skinner has a theory of language and language use. Chomsky's going to lay on this nativism and this mentalism and all this Chomskyan worldview. That's not it at all.
Yeah.
There's a little part at the end where Chomsky speculates on the brain being wired up for language, but it's a little part. You can just snip it out. It's a long review. His main argument is extremely powerful, which is just, and it's an argument of tremendous logical force. And Chaz Firestone and a student recently published an article using exactly the same form against a neuroscience theory. The argument is basically, if you take what Skinner's saying seriously, literally, it's obviously false.
Yeah.
If you take what he's saying metaphorically, like we find some things reinforcing, I find it reinforcing to talk to you guys, then in a metaphorical sense, it's true, but it's just empty. It just says, I'm enjoying talking to you guys.
Yeah.
And so he devastates the Skinnerian attempt to extend these notions of operant conditioning to human behavior. And just watching this at work. Now, a lot of the review, it gets really in the weeds. Some of it may be unfair, attacking Skinner for views he didn't hold. But the core of it is brilliant. It'd be a fun paper to talk about.
It is a great paper. You, I think you suggested it to me early on in graduate school, and it always struck me as exactly that. Like, it's not Chomsky saying, "Oh no, nativism is true. Nativism is true." It's yeah. A vicious takedown of like, well, if this is what you mean by reinforcement, then it means nothing, right? Like, yeah. It's just circular and broad and vacuous, and that is. Exactly, sort of to bring it back to the cargo cult science, it was science-y. And it was more science-y than psychology has ever really gotten. I mean, it's as science-y as you can get. The rigor, you know, this was just straight up positivism with the rigor of, well, only behavior, only things that are observable, and yet he had to rely on this definition of reinforcement that was self-defeating. And yeah, it's a brilliant takedown.
And we've talked before about styles. And one thing I don't like about Chomsky and also Fodor is I've seen a lot of critiques which are generous in their tone and, you know, trying to find the best view and trying to be civil. And Chomsky is surprisingly mean. And in all of his critiques and all of his writing, when he defeats an enemy, it's like he's attacking, you know. A lot of Chomsky's work is political, and he brings the same fervor one gives to fighting the fascists against fighting people who disagree with him, even over the most subtle linguistic theory. So, you know, he's ripping into somebody who has a different notion of verb movement in Dutch. And, you know, it's like this person is Hitler. And so the overall tone of Chomsky's review is, I think, unnecessarily savage, but it's a brilliant work.
He's a methodological terrorist.
Do we have time for one more quick topic?
Yeah. Well, I do.
Tamler, I have another appointment on Wednesday.
another live stream.
There's another YouTube live stream. Now he knows that it is live and it is video.
Yeah.
So someone asked me, or someone asked us, how much do you censor your sense of humor in front of your kids? Is Eliza still not allowed to say bad words? And this reminded me of another question we got, I think. Not at all. And that's been true, like, since she was like 5 years old. I had, because I was an only child, I had for first 14 years of my life, like, that's kind of how my parents treated me. And it's definitely how I've been with Eliza treated. Like, I kind of, even when it seemed shockingly inappropriate, given her age, just kind of assumed that she would get jokes and that she would know the difference between saying something kind of purposely shocking and saying something truly offensive. And I think that actually works. Like, I'm a big fan of respecting your And I think, you know, it's more complicated if you have more kids, maybe if you have a boy instead of a girl, but yeah, that's my, I don't censor. In fact, Eliza, if she was here, would probably say she wishes I would censor more.
Apparently I muted part of that because I was coughing, but I think they got
I bared my heart about being a parent. That is unbelievable.
Most of it. Tamler, the part that the relevant part, I think everybody heard, which is that you don't believe
it was all relevant.
Yes. that you don't believe in censoring yourself.
No censoring and respecting your kids, watching R-rated movies with your kids, all of that I'm fully 100% in favor of. But I've had one.
It
worked really well with her, but I don't know how it would work with, you know.
I will admit, though, and I think I've said this before, maybe even on the balanced play diets, I have never censored sort of my daughter, you know, my daughter's embarrassment is what prevents her from watching certain movies with me, because she just doesn't want to see sex scenes with me in the room. But in terms of violent movies, I've never cared. And I wonder if I would feel differently if she were a boy. And Paul is the father of two boys who have just a bit more testosterone floating around that makes them aggressive. Did you actively censor?
So both of my sons now are in their 20s. One's in law school, the other one's a philosophy undergraduate. And I still censor myself in front of them. I was more permissive about violence, and I wasn't that disturbed about violent video games. But I tried to sort of in some way titrate their environments in different ways. I think I haven't worked this out, and I'm not talking about long-term effects. I'm just talking about the kids' happiness, because I really am consistent on this. I don't think you change your kids that much. But I think you can make them happy and so on. I think that there's some things that kids should not yet be exposed to, or should be exposed to gradually. I don't think either of you do disagree with this that substantively.
No.
I do.
Do you disagree?
Well, it depends what depends what you're talking about.
Well, for instance, the world could be an outlandishly cruel place.
I would never want my daughter watching, you know, watch people die subreddit.
Right.
You shouldn't be watching that without your kids either.
No. But I do remember I was playing what's that zombie show? Walking Dead. I was playing on my iPad one of those storytelling games where you like choose your own adventure, but for your iPad. And Bella was very small. And I remember it was at night, and I freaked her the fuck out with like a scene where a zombie was attacking. And to this day, she says that affected her, like that she's always been like really afraid of zombies. And I feel a little bit bad.
Except now, being afraid of zombies is very rational.
Yeah, she's...
You know, it's just kind of an edge if the virus goes to Alders.
Oh, man. But I never cursed in front... The first time my daughter heard me cursing was when I moved to Toronto and Tamler and I were recording. This was in 2013. And I had a sort of a open floor plan apartment in the only area of Toronto I could afford to live in, way west on Queens. I'd never cursed in front of my daughter. I don't curse in front of my parents. I obviously curse. I don't mind cursing. But that recording with Tamler was the first time she heard me dropping F-bombs on the regular.
Really?
Yeah.
I have a story of my older son and cursing. I also wouldn't curse in front of my kids. I don't actually like when
really?
Kids.
I'm surprised.
I don't know. I'm a gentle.
Rude to me.
But at one point I come home and my son Max was with his babysitter, Adina. And he came up to me later and he was talking. He says, "Dad, do you know what the worst swear word of all is?" And I said, "What is it?" And he said, "It's damn." And I say, well, yeah, that is a swear word, and people get upset by it. Why do you think it's the worst? And he says, well, my babysitter says fucking shit all the time, but she never says damn. So, that's also a very good language acquisition.
That is, yeah, it's Gabba Guy.
Do you guys swear in your lectures?
Yes, I do.
Paul? I don't. I quote the famous Philip Larkin, "They Fuck You Up" poem. But I don't swear in my lectures. Do you swear for emphasis, either of you? Is that when you, how you do it? Or?
Yeah. I swear for emphasis. It sort of lapses into my colloquial swearing. But I like it when there's a point that I want them to remember. You know? Like, suppose that I want them to learn about that memory isn't, you know, a perfect recording of your perception. And I say something, you know, it's not a fucking videotape, right? Like, that. I want them to remember that.
That's good use of swearing.
Yeah.
And sometimes, like, something is fucked. Like, if you're describing something that's fucked, there's no other way to say that. You can say it's messed up, but that's not the same as saying that it's fucked. And so I think you just sometimes, for just the descriptive nature of it, need to do it.
Like when you're talking about fucking, like, you know, what are you going to say, having sex?
Like no, fucked. Like a situation is fucked.
Yeah. I've only had one time I got an email from a student saying that she was a Christian and she would appreciate it if I cursed less during lecture. And I said, sorry, I didn't mean to offend you. I'll try to curse less. Most kids find it entertaining, but it's not important enough to me that I'm going to like die on that hill. I have to.
Yeah, it's not a hill necessarily to die.
It is fun, but though. It just makes it. Most of the time when I'm lecturing up there, if given those lectures so many times, I'm just trying to entertain myself, really.
But also, there is the kind of professor that swears too much, you know, like to try to look cool. And you don't want to be that professor.
Yeah.
It's a guy. It's definitely a guy. And so it's a balance. It's tricky.
Either of you seen the new Louis C.K.? I haven't yet seen it.
I haven't seen it yet.
I did.
You did? Worth
it? Yeah. Barely, maybe. Yeah. I would say like the first half of it is pretty funny. I think the parts where he tries to get a little edgier and then tries to address his situation are, it doesn't totally work. And I don't know, the whole thing just seemed a little seedier. And I'm probably someone who isn't as appalled by the scandal as many
as I ought to be
maybe. But it was okay, but it wasn't great. I don't even know if I would recommend spending $8 on it. But it has a lot of funny things. There's definitely some good sequences in it. So it's not like you're be making a big mistake if you didn't, if you watched it. But the stuff, I don't know, I was hoping for more on the scandal, and whatever he gave, there were a couple of funny remarks about it, a couple of funny asides, but nothing like, you know, this guy I thought was a real artist and he could do something with that. And I don't think he did, like, I don't, or even came close.
No. That's enough for me not to not to watch it. Unfortunately.
I like that somebody said a new article on Vulture will be, here are the names of 500,000 people who downloaded Louis C.K.'s new special.
If you pirate, it's not wrong. All right. Anything else?
This was fun. Comment that the stream of people talking is great.
Yeah, it is. I am now wondering whether I should crop it at the point where the echo stops before I upload it.
No, just they should get the whole experience.
They should get the whole terrible, terrible experience. Next time it will go a lot smoother. I know what I did wrong. I know. All right.
All right, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Paul.
Thanks, Paul.
Thank you.
We'll send the checks in the mail.
Checks.